Yo, we are live on the air. Well, we're not actually truly live. I'm recording this. Welcome to the inside of Neil's Gear Room. Last time I did a video in here, it proved quite popular, so I thought I'd try another one and see how it goes. We're going to do English first, and then I'll talk about the same thing in Japanese. 最初英語をしゃべります。その後、後半は日本語で同じ話をやってみます。いけるかしら。ようこそ、Neil's Gear Room の内側です。So today, well actually, yesterday I was in Niseko and I was filming with Waji, amazing rider. And if you saw the vlog, I rode down to the bottom of the ski resort after we were finished and I ran into my friend Owen. And immediately he said, hey, Neil, you want to try this snowboard that I made? And I know that he had been making snowboards. This is one right here. And handmade snowboards in his small home factory, which I have not gone to see yet. And I knew he was making these boards. And I was like, yeah, I want to see your setup. And right away he saw me. And it's funny because he and I wear the exact same Volcom jacket, which is, we're like twins. So we have the same camouflage jacket on. Anyway, he said, look, I want you to test ride the board. You know, tell me what you think about it. Give it a review. And I said, hell yeah, I love doing that. So he took the binding straight off the board right there. And he lent me this, which is the Island 153 board. Now, this was made, handmade, in his home, garage, I guess. I don't know if that's rude to call it that way. His workshop, his factory, whatever you want to call it. But this is a handmade board made in Niseko, Japan. Get a little look at the shape here. I don't know if I'm doing a great job of this. You can see, we can really film it later and go over some of the details, but he's got a Japanese-made race-grade P-TEX sole. It's not a Yukita. This is a real snowboard. P-TEX sidewalls, he was telling me. Top sheet, very nice. He said he's not going to use this material again. I don't know why, but maybe he's got something better. And he told me he did not really like the way the tail shape came out, that he wants to do this a little different. He wants it to be coming up a little bit more. It's quite of a flat tail, and you can see the shape there. But, you know, I've never built a snowboard. I've been to many snowboard factories. I've been to the Burton factory. I've been to a couple different snowboard factories. So I've been to Rossignol factory many years ago. And, but I really know nothing about actual like board construction. You know, I know there's like wood and there's other materials, there's glue and things are pressed under pressure and you know, then you grind it and smooth it and, you know, a lot of different processes go into making a board. But I really don't understand the whole process of making boards. But what I'm trying to say is that it blows my mind that now someone in a small workshop, if they're dedicated enough and have the skills and study and figure things out, can produce a snowboard of this kind of quality. I think that's really cool. That's the first statement I want to make. I'm also kind of wondering if it's sort of something that larger snowboard companies are thinking about, worried about, concerned about. If this is something like a new direction. Now, the Yukita handmade bindingless snow surfer movement has really taken hold globally and become a big thing. And a lot of people are spending a lot more time on handmade snow surf type boards. And I'm thinking that translates to less snowboards being sold. I don't know. That's just my idea. If you have something that's fun and you can make it yourself, and you know, you don't need a snowboard as much anymore, you might not buy as many. I don't know. I'm not the economist and I don't know the whole industry. But if people start making high quality snowboards like this and they become sort of art pieces and collector's items and they're They're more like surfboards. You know, you can go to a surfboard shaper and get a really specific board for that coastline or whatever. Seems like that's kind of the direction maybe snowboard's going to be hitting. And I don't know, I like that. I think that's really, it's really, really cool. So today I'm going to put a little wax on this board, give it a little love, and then I'm going to take it out on the mountain and give it a ride and let Owen know what I think of it. Yes! Very, very cool, and congratulations, Owen. So he said that maybe next year he is going to try to produce a limited number. I won't say the exact number, because I don't want to make any promises. And he was telling me about the core, the wood core. Right now there's like some, there's a mix of foreign woods and Hokkaido woods, but he's got a new supply of wood cores, and it would be all Hokkaido wood. So that's the kind of thing I'm thinking. It's like, you'd come to Hokkaido, you'd go to Niseko, and there's already brands like Offshore, which is a small brand that has their factory in Moiwa, and they make and produce their boards there. And, you know, you could go there, you could go to, like, Offshore, you could go to, like, Island, Owen's place, and buy a board that's made with, like, Hokkaido wood, you know, handmade here on location, designed for the mountains and the snow here. And that seems really, really cool to me. What do you guys think? I'm sure there's small brands popping up all over the world. But, you know, there's like small brands, and then there's like really small. And like, Owen is like one guy, as far as I know. You know, then there's like brands where maybe they've gone out and got some venture capital, and they got some funding, and they have like, or they took over a factory that someone else had, and it's still a small operation, but they employ like, you know, quite a few people, and there's a lot of machinery. And there's that kind of level. And then you have the really gargantuan, you know, like Capita, like the mothership, like massive factory, or Burton, who has like, you know, factories around the world, or companies that use factories in China, etc., etc. So there's a lot of different levels of snowboard production. By the way, we should have a quick flex. It's always good to have a little flex, you know. When you go into a snowboard store, this is what everybody does. So, you give a little flex, but it can tell you a lot about a board. This is definitely soft. It's quite soft, springy, but I can feel there's more of a nice tension up here in the nose. If the nose is too soft, you can like go flying over the handlebars. But it looks like it's going to be super fun board, especially in the spring snow conditions we're experiencing now in Hokkaido. Early spring, folks, by the way. Everybody's talking about it, so I might as well talk about it. It's so funny, like, there's a state of depression going on in the snow community. Skiers, snowboarders, probably mountain climbers and all those people as well. You know, everybody, when you meet someone out at the hill or in the gondola or just wherever, and you know that they like snowy mountains as much as you do, what everybody's doing now is they go, oh, haru da ne, which is, haru means spring. So the conversation basically goes, oh, it's spring, yeah. Yeah, it's really, really spring-like, huh? Yeah, early spring, early spring, yeah. But, I've never seen it this early. Nah, I've never seen it this early. This is terrible. Yeah. Oh, but, you know, spring snow can... It's fun. It's fun. Corn snow. I love corn snow. Oh, I love the corn snow. Yeah, great. Okay. See you later, man. That's kind of like the conversation that's been going on everywhere. You kind of get tired of it after a little while. So I don't want to hear the word spring anymore. All right. Looking good. So, a race grade sole, or a race grade P-Tech sole, kind of seems to be a priority here in Japan. I think that has a lot to do with the fact that our mountains are not as steep. So you need every little ounce of speed that you can get. And having a very fast board is very important, or it's more important than it is in other parts of the world where you have steeper terrain and maybe harder snow conditions too. Because when it's rather flat and the snow gets deep, you need to float and you need to keep going. You don't want to get stuck in the deep powder. So that, I think, has led to people using, especially the Moss and Genten and Field Earth and all the Japanese brands, they've always used the really expensive, high-quality P-TEX soles. I love it. I think they're absolutely fantastic. Okay, now I'm going to try to do all of that in Japanese again and see if I can get it right. Because we're at 11 minutes already. ですね、今日はニールズギアルームの内側に来ております。で、この今ね、どれぐらいみんな理解したんですかね。僕の英語は結構聞きやすい、あ、そうだね、僕の英語は聞きやすいって言われるんだけど、今の会話みんな理解したんでしょうか。とりあえず、昨日に成功でワジと滑って撮影した帰り、ゲレンデ降りたら一番ボトムに僕とね、全く同じ、迷彩のボルコムのジャケット着てるオーエンっていう仲間に会いました。で、オーエンに会ったら、まあ、オーエンはこのスノーボードを手作りで自分の、ワークショップっていうか家の横に多分車庫で作ってると思うんだけど、板作ってるの俺知ってて、で、気になってて、そこ、見に行きたいなと思ってたんだけど、なかなかタイミングなくて、で、オーエンに会ったらいきなり板にいる、乗ってみるかいって言って、一本貸してあげるよって言ってくれて、それはもう絶対断るわけないでしょ。ぜひ、今持ってるのかい、あるかいって言ったら、いや、じゃあこれ今もうバインディング外してこれあげるよって言って、この板、アイランドっていう名前で153センチの板を、その場でいきなりバインディング外して渡してくれて、今借りてるところです。で、まあ、手作りだね。手作りのスノーボード。すごいよね。僕は、まあ、どんなスノーボードも、まあ、工場で作って、大きな工場で作ってても、まあ、いろんな人がいろんな機械を使って作ってるんで、どんなスノーボードも手作りとも言えると思うんだけど、まあ、これは本当に一人で全部、この何年間ちょっとずつこう準備してたみたいで、その中のコアを自分で作ったりで、プレスキーだったり、まあいろんなパーツを用意して、で、このトップシートの素材と、あとこのこれ日本の長谷川って言ってたかな、日本の P-TEX レースグレードっていうか、すごいいい P-TEX も使って、で、エッジ入れて、サイドウォールも、P-TEX のサイドウォール使ってて、これを作り上げてきた。で、158もあるのかな ?5853。で、これはたまたま、スコフっていうね、結構有名なアーティストのイラストをもらって、これもグラフィック自分でシルクスクリーンして入れて、そのオーエンのお兄ちゃんになるかな、あの、フランスの方でなんかロッジを経営してて、まあそのためのロゴを作ってもらったんだけど、まあこういう形で、手作りで板を作って今テストしてると。で、もしかして来年は、何十本なるのかな、何十本かはもう作って、そのブランドとして、まあ、やっていきたいという話をしてると。いや、これはすごいなと。まあ、最近この雪板のブーム、この何年間結構徐々に盛り上がってきて、まあ、手作りで、あの、ブランクスから、作っていくっていうのは、まあ、見えてきたよね。例えばこれは未だに僕は作ってません。これ雪板のブランクスです。これは、八戸のスクランブル USA の、ブランクスなんだけど、まあこれを切ってね、雪板にする人も多いんだけど、その文化がすごいこう盛り上がってるなと。 増えてるなっていうのはずっと見てて、とまあ小さいスノーボードブランドっていうのも結構世界中あちこち増えてきた。俺がよく最近見たのは、雪板も作ってるけどスノーボードでヨーロッパでコンボイっていう、ベンっていう人、僕のカーダンチの DVD にも出てるんだけど、彼はポゴスノーボードっていうブランドから脱退っていうか、引退してやめて、で自分で小さいブランドをまた作って、でそれをこう頑張ってるんだけど、さらに小さいと思うんですよ。もう基本的に一人でコアを作って、全部パーツ組み合わせてプレスしてシェイプしてっていう感じで、このスノーボードブランドをあの応援が作り上げてて、結構これってすごいことだなと。スノーボードのシーン、世界的にこれからそんな方向性に、わお、ワックスが飛んでったよ。どこ行った？おい、あれ、はい、すいません、帰ってきました。ワックスが飛んでったよ。スノーボードの業界そのものがどう考えてるのかなと。こういうこんなクオリティでスノーボードの制作、まあ、個人レベルでもできるんだったらどうなっていくんですかね。なんか俺は結構面白いというか、でもビッグブランドは結構心配なところなのかなと。やっぱり小さいブランド、まあマーケティングとか宣伝する力があまりないし、あちこちのお店に卸すっていうのは多分大変なんだけど、自分で作れる分自分で作ってそれを売るっていうのはできるし、まあ作品っぽくっていうか、すごい量を作るんじゃなくて、もうちょっと限定した数作ってそれだけ売りさばくっていうのはできるような気がして、これは本当ビッグブランドをどう考えてるか気になるなと。これからのまた 10年15年ぐらい、そういうシェイプ、スノーボードのシェーパー、雪板のシェーパーっていうのが結構今全国とか全世界にすごい増えてきて、雪板なんかかなりその感じがあるね。 もっと簡単って言ったら失礼だけど、このスノーボード作るよりは簡単なんじゃないかなと思うけどね。まあ物にもすごいよるかもしれないけどまあそんなことを考えながら、この仲間が手作りで作ったアイランド153をワックスかけております。乗るの楽しみだね。なんかそれも多分その手作りのスノーボードのまた一つのこう楽しみだね。その仲間だったり、まあ、あの人が手作りで作ったあの板乗ってみたいな、まあ、変な話、この形の153センチのスノーボードは普通にお店にあったら俺は選んで買わないと思うしね。自分にちょっと小さいと思うし、限られたコンディションでしか乗れないと思うけど、友達が作ったっていうだけで、まあ、知ってる人が作ったっていうだけで、なんか気持ちが違うもんね。乗ってみたいな、どんな感じだろうで、よりこうフィーリングをちゃんと考えながら乗るだろうしね。それが結構面白いな。まあみんな本当スノー業界そのものが、僕がスノーボード35年間やってて、その中ですごい変わってきたんだけど、この10年もかなりのスピードでいろいろ変わってきてるから、みんなどう感じてるか、フレームアウトしてきちゃったね。ぜひ教えてほしいですね。意見などコメントで残してください。あとね、もう一つ、なんか最近一回コメント来て、で後から探したらちょっと消えてて、どこ行ったか分かんないんだけど、2つ来てたね。ナオバインディングっていいですか、気に入ってますかっていうコメントもあったし、 あと K2TT のブーツ、履いてるのを見ましたけど、あれはいいですか、どう思ってますかっていう、質問来てましたね。どっちも最高です。ナオバイニング、このスケートテック、この下のこのパーツが動くんだよね。でここにゴムが、これ今ちょっと取れてるけど、ここに4つゴムを入れるんだよね。これ最高です。はい。なんで最高か、なんだろうな、真ん中のディスクからバイニング方引っ張るっていうよりも、体重かけた方、当サイドなら当側に体重かけたら、本当この4つの角、このゴムあるポイントにプレッシャーがかかる考えだと思います。そういう理論だと思う。そうじゃないバイニングは真ん中のディスク、ネジが3つとか4つがあって、でグッっていったらそれをこう引っ張り上げて前に倒すとか後ろに倒すとか、ちょっと違う感じするんですよね。まああとホールド性と、ヒールカップが他のバイニングよりちょっと高い位置にあって、俺はすごく相性がいいです。まあみんなそれぞれだと思うんだけど。でブーツは、K2TT ブーツ今年履いて、ソフトブーツですね。あの柔らかいけどハイエンド、まあコンストラクションはすごい丈夫でクオリティのいいもののソフトフレックス、これはすごく相性いいです。バッチリです。今シーズン全く問題ないです。でなんかいろいろボアがどうしたっていう人もいるし、なんか足首のホールド性がどうのとかなんか言う人もいるけど、僕は全然問題ない。でブーツって緩むんだよね、あの滑ってる間に。で緩んできたなと、あと雪のコンディションがちょっと硬くなったりボコボコしてきたらボアを締め直す。僕はもうそれだけ、ボアを締め直せば、なんか引っかかってる、全然それだけでまたフレックスが調子よくなって、滑り続けることができてます。全然問題ないです。それより僕の今のこのワックスペーパーのかけ方が全然うまくいってないです。何なんだろう。そしてあれだね、結構汚れてました。ワックスペーパー見える？すごいね。おい、いた、汚いよ。これね、春雪がすっごいいろんな汚れが入ってて、何が入ってるかっつったら PM2.5 だよ、この野郎。この PM2.5 やろう、最悪だよ、ほんと最悪。最近これが多くて、空がもう真っ白になって、で黄砂もあるけど PM2.5 だよ、完全に汚染されてる。これ大問題ですね。これがあの板のソールにも入ってワックスペーパーを使うと見えてきます、出てきます。はい、これまたすげえ汚い。わお、これちょっと汚いぜ。やっといてよかったわ。最後、今のブーツの話だけ英語でやります。 So I was just saying, I got a comment the other day. Someone was asking me about my K2TT boots and if I liked them. And for some reason that comment, I don't know, it disappeared. I lost it or I erased it or that person erased it. I don't know. I couldn't find it. But I just wanted to say that I really have enjoyed the K2TT boots this season. I've been riding them all season. The last few seasons I was riding DC boots. And those were good boots as well. I still have them up here on my shelf. But right this season I rode the K2TT boots all season after I got them. They've been fantastic. And they're a high-end soft flex boot. So I've never liked stiff boots, so I went very easily to a soft flex boot like that. But they're different from other boots. I have always been like cutting my boots and customizing my boots to make them soft. So these boots are great because they were designed to be that way. They're soft right out of the box. But the good thing is you can crank down that boa. And I actually like the boa. Some people have left comments saying they don't think the boa is a good thing. I have had great luck with it. You do it just right in the morning, not too tight. Go for a couple runs. The boots get softer and loosen up after you take a couple runs. And then I just pull up my wear and crank down that boa a little bit more to a good tightness that I like. And I do that several times in the day if needed, especially with the spring snow, because the snow conditions can change dramatically throughout the day. Be hard in the morning, then get softer, then get hard again. You know, it's very variable. So I will adjust the boa as I go for each run, and I've had great luck with that. The heel hold is fine for me. Yeah, all around warm. I thought they were great. I thought they were really, really, really good boots. So, thumbs up. I think it's worth trying a softer boot. You know, some people, oh man, I don't know. You know, even on steep terrain and in more technical terrain, I think oftentimes, you know, some people that all they've ridden is really stiff boots their whole life, and they don't know what it's like to be able to really bend your knees and get down and really work with the board. You know, it's always about this triangle, this solid rock of a triangle, your hips and the board boots and your hips, you know. And yeah, I think it's worth trying a softer boot and see what you think. So again, thanks to Owen for lending me the board. I'll do a vlog where I ride it and you'll see what I think about it. And let me know other small handmade board brands around the world. If you have some recommendations or some friends who are doing this, please let me know in the comments below. And that is the inside of Neil's gear room today. It's getting dark. It's time to go and have dinner with the family. See you guys later. Always unplug your iron, folks. Very nice. Very nice.